Extraordinary People. Proudly sponsored by Amazing Space Loft Conversions. Creating a better space for extraordinary living.
My guest is one of Britain's leading figurative painters. His career has spanned four decades and his work exhibited worldwide to international acclaim. He has been described as the Alfred Hitchcock of painting, and aspects of his creations have also been compared to those of Constable, Rothko and Peter Doig. Collectors of his work have included Peter Gabriel, Anita Roddick and American business magnate and film producer David Geffen. I visited the artist Graham Dean at his Brighton studio.
So here we are in your studio, Graham. Thank you so much for inviting us.
Oh, you're welcome.
I'm very excited about this because I have been a fan of your work for a few years, and I was thinking that I was going to perhaps start by talking about your very specific style, the very Graham Dean kind of effect of, you know, the watercolor on paper, the way it absorbs, and you know, the kind of blotching effect.
Washes.
Fine, but then I looked at your early work and I was completely stunned because it's like somebody else.
It is. I think it was someone else, yeah.
And so that's why I thought perhaps we should go back to the beginning and put things in context before we get to the style that perhaps kind of describes you now. So, shall we do that?
Okay, good.
Let's go back. You grew up in Liverpool.
Well, Birkenhead.
Okay, so
across the water, across the Mersey. Yeah,
okay.
Yeah.
And Liverpool in the 60s, although you were very young, was obviously a very artistic, vibrant, exciting.
A cauldron, probably, yeah. And of course, you don't realise it when you're living there, do you? You just think this is normal.
Right.
So I used to see TV crews on the streets in Liverpool and just think, oh, probably every city's got this, you know, you don't know.
So I think the poet Adrian Henry said, you know, if he would have taken more notice,
yes, that was a great quote. I know exactly what he means by that. He just didn't realise it. I used to go down to the Cavern and had friends who played in bands and things. But I was young, so I had to go to lunchtime sessions there.
Right.
And kid on.
But you are, or maybe you became aware of it later, that perhaps then, unlike maybe other places or other eras, it wasn't uncommon for artists who, for example, were painters to have a go at music, and musicians to have a go at poetry, and that kind of...
That's the 60s. Then.
That's the 60s.
Yeah, it was 60s into the early 70s. And, I mean, my best friend at our college played in a band. I mean, so I used to hang around with him, you know. So, mostly... How many painters I knew became guitarists, or the other way around?
Right.
Hell of a lot. It was that sort of mix. But I love that.
But yeah. You have been a little bit like this anyway.
Yeah, I guess so. Mixing with musicians now, and which I've done for the past 20 years, I suppose.
Right,
yeah.
Okay. And then school, which wasn't so great.
A boys' grammar school. And if you're good at science and good at rugby, you'll be head boy. Well, I didn't exactly fit in there.
Right.
So in that period, you could go to art college really early. And so I went when I was 16, which is unheard of, really. But and then did a two-year pre-dip course. But when I got there, I thought, oh, these are my people at last.
Right.
People understood you, you know. And I just flew from then on. I loved it. Absolutely loved it.
Right.
But school now.
No. I read that something that you would never forget, one of your teachers mocked you for your Bob Dylan.
Oh, God, well, yes,
passion.
At school, yeah. We could do anything we wanted to do. One of those rare occasions, write about something you're passionate about. And I wrote about Bob Dylan and said, well, I think he's a poet. And this is early days, so he'd only just done Tambourine Man and things like this. And I quoted the lyrics, and he read it all out in class to his other classes, mocking me, you know, saying, you know, which is dreadful.
I know.
I mean, I couldn't believe it. I shook my head then. I thought, I want to get the hell out of here.
And so you did, and you found your place at art school.
Yeah.
And then what happened?
Well, I did 2 years there, and I said to you before, I said I wasn't exactly the best, you know, so... but I was probably about third.
No, that's pretty good.
Yeah, it's okay. But there were some were really good at drawing, some really good at painting. And they sort of encouraged me to take up graphics because they thought my work had a certain graphic element, which I don't think it really did. So I just believed them and applied, got in to Bristol. And then within a year, I suddenly realised, this is not me. You know, this is terrible. And I wanted to leave, so I had a chat with the lecturers, and they persuaded me to stay on if I could do, you know, said that, well, you can do some of your own work.
Right.
Maybe do 30% of the course, but then the rest of the time do your own work.
That wouldn't happen today.
No way.
To say to someone, do 30% of the work and the rest of the time you can do.
I don't know why they did it. I set up a studio within a studio on my own, and I started doing... Yeah, exploring my own work. It would never happen now. I mean, one of the few things I learned, though, because I did things like calligraphy, for God's sake, which I absolutely hated, you know, old-fashioned pen calligraphy. But then also we did typefaces, and we learned how to construct sentences, what type to use, and more importantly, the space that you put letters next to each other. And they called it negative space.
And that really affected your subsequent work.
It did. I suddenly realised that 90% of art is about negative spaces.
Right.
You're looking at these gaps in right. between the main subject.
Rather
and you've got to get that balance
them.
Right. You know. So that one thing came out of that was negative spaces.
Right, which is one important thing. And so then after college, when was a kind of... a breakthrough for you in terms
of... Well, I had a show when I was at college in Bristol Art Centre, so I kidded on, I wasn't a student, and I had a show there.
Right.
So that was the first time, and I sold. I said, people actually like my work. You know. It then took another, I think, a year and a half or 2 years to get in with the gallery, but that was really quick.
Right, and the Treadwell...
Yeah, it was the Treadwell Gallery,
It wasn't looked
fairly
upon...
Fairly notorious.
Right.
Yes, yeah.
Notorious because what? Because they used art as a kind of... with merchandise and things that were looked upon as not the right thing to do.
Yeah, he did that, which is now very common. So some of the things he did, he was way ahead of the game. He was a populist. I mean, I think that's why they didn't like him. And he tended to veer that way. After a while, I suddenly realised I don't like the direction it's going, and I wanted to get out. It took me a long time to leave.
But before you left, there are a couple of pictures that...
I know, which will happen.
Let's talk about
one
them,
or two of
them,
certainly more popular. Yeah.
So the first one, Refugees from...
Refugee from England,
right.
Which was... it was an invite show to do a new portrait of the Queen, a different alternative version. And I came up with this image where I used... all the imagery from souvenir shops that you get in London around Lambeth Bridge and these places. And I picked them all out and put them all together in this composite picture, really, featuring the Queen, which sat on a type of throne. But it took off. I mean, it took off internationally.
And I mean, today you can see those kind of mocks of celebrities or the monarchy or whatever, but I guess at the time it was something completely different.
It was they said it was a bit of a shock.
Right.
I didn't think of it particularly, but I was more in a state of surprise, really, that people picked up on it so much, you know.
Right.
It was even on Blue Peter, of all things.
Right.
Extraordinary, you know.
Right.
But internationally it was in... hundreds of magazines, covers of magazines.
Right. And then there was the boxer, the...
Yeah, only a year later. I mean, you got to remember, I was only about 22, 23 when I did this.
So young.
Yeah, and I was learning. I was still learning because I didn't go to a fine art course, so I was almost learning from painting to painting. You could see the change. And within a year, the difference between those two pictures is staggering. But that was a breakthrough painting for me, and... I got a friend of mine to model for it, and he only reminded me about this about a couple of months ago. I completely forgotten, but I got him to run around the block about six or seven times
to get to the breathing and
feeling of slumped exhaustion from this pugilist. But the idea came about from Oxford, because they had a traveling fair in Oxford, and they had a boxing booth where these sort of amateur, well, they must have been ex-professionals, were strutting along like a catwalk. And they invited all on, you know, anyone to have a go, really, in the ring. And I was watching these boxers and thinking, there's an idea there, you know, I quite like this.
Right.
So I went back and sketched it all out. Anyway, so I got, well, we got them in the studio and had them made up, and it really worked.
That's
and it's still one of my favourite pictures. But the it sold within, I think, the first show it was shown in, it was sold.
So we're going to take a little break now. Okay. And talking about sailing, we'll talk about some of your collectors as
okay.
well.
Okay, all right.
Extraordinary People. Proudly sponsored by Amazing Space Loft Conversions. Creating a better space for extraordinary living. Extraordinary People. Proudly sponsored by Amazing Space Loft Conversions. Creating a better space for extraordinary living.
Welcome back. I'm in Graham Dean's studio and we were just talking about the picture, The Pugilist. So there's a nice story behind that one.
Yeah, it wasn't nice at the time.
Right.
A collector bought it in the first showing, but he hung it. And then his friends and his family started saying they hated it.
Right.
They found it so ugly and aggressive. So he stuck it in the loft. And I only found this out because he died not long ago and his sister told me. But it's in the loft for 40 years.
40 years forgotten, more or less.
Well, he knew it was there. She didn't know it was there. She inherited this house.
His sister.
Found the painting in the loft. Hated it again. And then sold it to the estate agent. So, but this is going to be a show coming up, and going to be first time in 40 years it's been seen. You know?
Right.
But I didn't know it'd been tucked away that long.
Right.
But that happens with my work a lot, that sort of thing.
And you are very prolific, and there's a lot of work, you know, around. So that was in the mid 70s, and you were
76.
76, yeah. And you were in London.
Yeah.
And you were having quite a wild time in London.
Well, I was staying with the Landesmans, Jane Fran Landesman. I think I painted, I'm not too sure if I painted that there, maybe I did.
So they were an American couple that came to England and they were...
Who were beaten, part of the Beat Generation, but they ran a club in St. Louis called the Crystal Palace, and they knew all these odd people like Jack Kerouac and strange oddballs. So these oddballs tended to come to the house and I would go down in the morning and you find these strange people having breakfast. It was great. I mean, I loved it.
And you met Tom Waits?
He came around one day as well, his first appearance in London and his hat on. Oh, yeah, yeah. Came up to my studio and he said, "I dig your work, man, dig your work." Yes, and we thought, who is this guy? He's our age, but he sounds like 52, you know?
Right.
But then he played us this record and we went, whoa, that's good.
Right.
He's going to be big, you know, just knew it. So, but it's great. I loved it. I loved these characters wandering in and out. And some of them I'd seen off the television, hadn't seen for years. Others I just didn't know about, didn't know their
right.
histories, but started to learn. You know, again, it's like, you know, I was a young man. I was, you know,
I do think that's
affected
it. I mean, apart from enjoying it, but in terms of art and...
Yes, it's coming in, all that input. You know, you've got to get good output when you've got all that input coming in.
Right.
Yeah.
So then people, well, let's do some name dropping, shall we? People started collecting your work.
Yes.
So
everyone wants to know about the name dropping. Yes.
Go on. Yeah. So there's Peter Gabriel.
Yes, I met him because we were both interested in videos at the time. Very early days in videos, he hadn't, you know, rock video hadn't taken off the way it had. He hadn't done his groundbreaking stuff. And we just talked, bandying around ideas, really, about videos. And then, and I did work on several projects with him over the years, and he bought my work. But one day he rang me up and he said, Anita Roddick, who runs a body shop, has rung up to say, do you know anyone visually interesting, creative? Because she has a problem in her design department, and I think they were doing something on climate change. and she got stuck. The whole department got stuck. You know.
Very
early on.
Climate change.
We're talking 86, remember. And so he said, oh, yeah, well, Graham Dean lives along the coast from you. Maybe you should call in. But he failed to tell her I was a painter. He just said, creative person, you know. Anyway, at that particular time, I'd just bought the house we're in, and I'd spent all my money, and we really were broke. We didn't have any money. And it was a Sunday morning, and I remember we sat down on the kitchen table, and I showed my wife the finances. I said, sorry, you know, we're down to the last 100 or 200, that's it. Oh, God. I said, but I'll get back to this, because I've got this woman coming around, Anita Roddick, to bandy around a few ideas, you know. Anyway, so the doorbell goes, and this small bombshell comes in, you know, full of life. It says, I've been up all night on a plane from Venezuela or something. And it's just, who did these paintings? I said, well, me, didn't Peter tell you I was an artist? She said, no, who did? You did them. Are they for sale? And I was trying to act cool and said, well, they could be. And she said, and we discussed prices. And she said, okay, I'll have that one. And all this happened in the space of about 15 minutes.
Wow.
Plus a discussion about the problem she had about the climate change.
Right.
It was like, and then she wrote a check and said, I've got to go. I just went.
And
we were sat there looking at this check. What happened? What happened there? But it's £10,000.
Amazing. Which was, it's a lot of money, but it was a hell of a lot of money.
Yes. And we were suddenly out of our debts and into a new world. And she became a patron for the next 10 years, really. And
nice.
I bought a lot of work. And I did work on quite a few projects with Amnesty International, loads of things.
Right.
So it's great. Right. And a good friend. Same as Peter, a good friend.
Have things in life, you know.
Yeah, I know. You just think.
But it's not just the kind of celebs. It's a nice story of some builders that appreciated
it. Well, I know. Yes, but that's the more popular story. And it was the Compartment series, which three paintings, all of which, I was living in Oxford then, and they were based on events which had happened to me on the Oxford to London train. Because it's my regular thing at that time. And I used some elements from the past as well, including the skinheads. And that was a direct relation to Burke and Head, really, because skinheads used to wait for the art students to come out and attack them, really.
Right.
So I painted these paintings. And I, for the first time, I got them all out onto the terrace, which was in Parktown in Oxford, a very posh bit of Oxford. And this, it must have been 18 foot long, this series of paintings, because of the life size. And I was photographing them, and suddenly I heard all this applause. I looked round, and there were these roofers, all these builders working on roof in Parktown, and they're all watching me, applauding the paintings. I thought, wow, maybe I've got a hit here. You know, it's the first time anyone had seen them. And the first time I'd seen them in line, I hadn't seen them before. Right.
Very nice. So, you know, you kind of appeal to different segments.
This
particular work and related works have been particularly interesting in that you have created, the centre of attention is not quite in the subject of the picture,
yes,
but you kind of look through windows.
Well, the compartments one, the two skinheads are looking outside the picture plane. And I quite like that concept. That's something different.
And the Alfred Hitchcock...
A critic said that about my earlier work. I was the Alfred Hitchcock of British painting. And I thought, whoa, really?
I didn't realise it.
And then I went back to look at his films, like Rear Window and things, and I saw exactly what he was talking about. And, of course, I acted a bit more like a film director the way I put these together. But also, I was really influenced by film at that time. So
let's now move to the more current work. You've developed a very interesting, unusual technique with tilting the paper and...
Well, that's because there's so much water on the paper, that's why. But it's quite organic the way it worked. I didn't start off thinking I'm going to do all this, it just developed. Because when I changed to watercolour, you couldn't buy large sheets of watercolour. You could only, about that big, called imperial size it was called. So I wanted to make large pictures. I wanted to do the same I was doing before, you know, with the really big ones. And so I had to devise a technique to to make these larger. So I started overlapping them in the drawing process and painting each sheet separately. And then ripping and tearing, I would collage them together to
form. You literally
form.
Rip.
Yeah, I do. Yeah,
Reverse archaeology.
It's called reverse archaeology. An archaeologist, when I was at the British School in Rome, came into the studio and said, "You're doing exactly the opposite to what we're doing. We're
creating the layers.
You're going upwards, creating the layers. We're trying to go downwards." You know.
And so after London, and obviously before that, Liverpool and Bristol and Oxford, you ended up here in Brighton.
Yeah, we moved down about 86, and I think 86, 87 to Brighton, yeah. And that was a good move. And it was odd because I'd read about Matisse and Picasso moving to the south of France, and they said the work changed because the light and colour came into the work and more dramatic forms. And I used to read and think, I don't know if I believe that. You know. And the same thing happened here. And I don't know if it's the amount of UV or we're near the sea here, maybe all the light bouncing off the sea.
Right.
But I suddenly started doing much brighter colours, so which I didn't do. I'm far more muted by early works. And see, all this complementary colours started creeping in.
Right.
And that was a surprise. As much as the watercolour was a surprise, that was a surprise.
So, wow. Okay, so we're here in Brighton. I'm sure it's not the last we'll hear of you, because your work is evolving and changing all the time. Thank you so much for inviting us to the studio.
Okay, that's great. Thanks.
Thank you.
Extraordinary People, proudly sponsored by Amazing Space Loft Conversions, creating a better space for extraordinary living.